My coverage of CES 2025 is brought to you by Lexar, MSI, Thermaltake, and Gigabyte.
The NVIDIA CES 2025 keynote, for those of us who are mostly interested in gaming graphics cards, boils down to this slide right here that they revealed fairly early on in the presentation. It has four new RTX 50 series GPUs listed and their prices. The RTX 5090 is going to be $2,000, $1,999. More than the 4090, less than what 4090 is typically sold for. Good or bad, I don't know. At least it's not $2,500. You guys let me know in the comments if you think that's ridiculous or not. The 5080 is gonna be $1,999, which is actually a little bit less than the 4080 was originally. It started at $1,200. $1,000 is still a lot for a graphics card, but NVIDIA could have charged more. There's not a lot of competition in this range. The RTX 5070 Ti is gonna be $750, and then the RTX 5070 is gonna be $550. Some of these prices seem somewhat reasonable in the current market of RTX 40 series GPUs and pricing. And in particular, what Jensen told us about the RTX 5070 is that it performs at the same level as a current RTX 4090, which is a pretty huge gap. And that sounds really good, but I think we should take that with a grain of salt because they also introduced DLSS 4.0. And they showed a demo of DLSS 4.0 that was quite impressive. Now, there's still a lot that we don't know about DLSS 4.0, what all is included and its capabilities. They were showing things like RTX neural material, what they call a transformer, RTX neural faces, but the thing that caught my ear and that made me somewhat suspect the comparison of an RTX 5070 performing on the same level as an RTX 4090 is that DLSS 4 also generates beyond frames, according to what Jensen said, up to three additional frames per each actual frame that's calculated by the GPU. But frame generation isn't a 100% solution. Here's more performance, here are more frames. It might improve the smoothness of the game that you might be playing, but it's not giving you more information from the game engine that you would have had earlier via traditional rendering methods. So this is the information that was shared that I think we should take with the largest grain of salt and wait for those independent reviews to come out. These cards should start launching in January. They also just said they're gonna start launching one of these four cards in January, so we don't know which one is gonna come out first, and probably it's going to be an initial launch in January, followed up by subsequent launches of the other GPUs. We also don't know which GPU is going to launch first, but I have a sneaking suspicion it's gonna be the RTX 5080, because I also have a sneaking suspicion that that was the card that Jensen was holding up on stage. Hold on just a second, Paul, don't get too hasty there. I have confirmed with NVIDIA, that was a 5090. It was a 50, it's only like a two slot card. That animation, that cooler, that is a 5090. It's way smaller. And I think they were being very careful with how they were introducing the products that they were talking about. And Jensen in particular, when he first started talking about the RTX 50 series, introduced it as the RTX Blackwell family.
The RTX Blackwell family. Let's take a look.
That's when they showed the new vapor chamber cooler, which has two pass-through fans. And again, pretty cool visual of how that card is designed. And I think that thanks to the fact that they're able to keep the PCB so small and have two pass-through cooling fans means that it will hopefully be a decent cooler if the current generation Founders Edition cards are any indication. They cool quite well. The stacks of the Blackwell chip that were presented, which again, I believe is gonna be the full-size Blackwell chip, which is probably gonna be cut down for other versions of the cards like the 5070, 5070 Ti, and so on. But it has 92 billion transistors, 4,000 trillion operations per second, 4 petaflops of AI performance, 1.8 terabytes per second of memory bandwidth, and at least visually speaking, the demo that they showed being rendered in real time by a Blackwell GPU was pretty impressive as it showed our DLSS 4 ray tracing techniques, and again, the amount of detail they can get by using AI to enhance the image, or in the case of frame generation, generate new frames for a smoother playback experience. The remainder of the keynote, which is still ongoing as I am filming this video because, you know, they kept going on and on, so I figured I'd just get started. Well, there was a lot of AI puffery, as you might imagine. AI was everywhere. They did the usual recap of NVIDIA's history going all the way back to 1993 and how far they've come with a typical graph showing a bar going up without any markers to indicate how that bar went up or how it was measured. If you're wondering how they're going to be using these Blackwell GPU dies that might go into RTX 5090s or 5080s and so on, but also will be used a lot in AI implementations, they have a new Grace Blackwell NVLink 72 solution. This was demonstrated by Jensen pulling out a massive shield that he held with sort of a layout of that configuration on it, which is pretty insane because it has 72 Blackwell GPUs, 14 terabytes of memory, 2,592 Grace CPU cores, and 18 NVLink switches providing 130 terabytes per second of bandwidth on one Grace Blackwell NVLink 72 thing. I have no idea how much those are going to cost, but of course NVIDIA is offering to sell them to data centers where they'll deliver them and set them up and install them for you so that data centers can make more money with AI. It's always sort of nebulous to me. Like how exactly do they go from we have more AI computing power now to money coming in? But apparently that's what happens because that's what Jensen has been spending most of the time focusing on. As the keynote continued, Jensen talked about lots of stuff related to lots of other industries, like their work with logistics and factories and creating digital twins of factories to enhance efficiency, or their work in the automotive space. All that is very interesting if you're into that sort of thing, and if you are, I highly recommend checking out the full NVIDIA keynote because there were some pretty cool demos in there. I was trying to find out what else was new and exciting for the people who are into PC gaming other than Jensen's new shiny leather jacket, of course, which is even newer and shinier and seems like it has tessellation or something built in. On the hardware side, I found Project Digits to be somewhat interesting. This is basically NVIDIA taking their DGX supercomputer that they first debuted back in 2016 and shrinking it down to a very small form factor, about the size of a Nook, so you can just have it on your desk. So you can have like a cloud computing platform that just sits on your desk. This uses a new chip that NVIDIA built along with MediaTek. It's called the GB10 superchip that combines both a Blackwell GPU as well as Grace cores that fuse together with the cool animation, of course. But it also includes 128 gigabytes of low-power DDR5X memory, a 4 terabyte SSD, and it has out-of-the-box capability to do a lot of the AI stuff that NVIDIA has been talking about throughout the keynote. You could even stack a couple of them together if you wanted. But it turns out that for anyone who is really interested in as much information as NVIDIA was willing to provide about the RTX 50 series, other than the 4 GPUs and the prices and the rough time frame for the launch that they debuted at the beginning, they have a landing page that went live on their website about the RTX 50 series that includes not only the 4 GPUs, but even some NVIDIA-provided performance comparison numbers, which should be taken with a grain of salt, but I do appreciate that they tested a variety of games and they were comparing each card to its last generation version. So the 5090 is compared to the 4090, 5080 compared to the 4080, 5070 Ti compared to the 4070 Ti, and the 5070 is compared to the 4070. And here I think I can use this information, even though it's a little bit vague in typical NVIDIA style, to somewhat verify my assumption that Jensen's claim that the RTX 5070 is equivalent to an RTX 4090 in performance was a little bit misleading. I have a feeling he's talking about with all the DLSS4 features turned on, especially the ones that the 4090 doesn't support. The best example of this is the Far Cry 6 performance data on these charts, which clearly shows the 5070 outperforming a 4070 by, it looks like, 25-30%. It's really hard to tell without lines or clear information on the x-axis on this graph. Or is that the y-axis? Anyway, but if we flip to the 5090, we can see it's outperforming the 4090 by a similar margin. It looks, again, by, I'm going to say, roughly 20-25% or so. I'll post a link to this landing page down in the video's description if you want to take a look at these graphs for yourself or read up about any of the other information on the technology that's enabled by the RTX 50 series, which, to be clear, I'm excited about these new graphics cards. I've been looking forward to them coming out. We have to view them with some amount of scrutiny, though, because NVIDIA has been a bit cagey with how they've done pricing in the past, and really, that's what it boils down to for these cards. What is the raw performance going to be, especially compared to last generation, and is NVIDIA really providing us with that next generation boost? Like, when Jensen first said a 5070 is like a 4090, I was like, that sounds really cool, that sounds like the kind of performance gains we used to get back in the day when they come out with new architecture. I don't think it's exactly going to be that with the RTX 50 series, but it does seem like NVIDIA hasn't gone too overboard with the pricing, and maybe my speculation from some months ago that NVIDIA is doing so well selling their AI GPUs, maybe they should be able to throw gamers a bone and not overprice their next-gen graphics cards. Maybe that's playing out just a little bit. I'm at least happy that the 5080 isn't more than $1,000, and I'm happy that the 5070 Ti isn't more than $750. And heck, I'm happy that the 5070 is going to be $550, not $600, or more than that. It's all somewhat relative, and I think for now, we can just be happy that we can get new gaming graphics cards. I guess the last thing that might be a bit of a question mark is availability. Are there going to be lots of these cards available since NVIDIA was supposed to initially start this new series a few months ago? But hopefully we can enjoy them for at least a few weeks before the robots take over, because that was also a big part of the presentation. Robotics, and apparently they're going to have the ChatGPT moment for robotics soon, also claims Jensen. What could go wrong? But that's all I have for you guys for this recap of the NVIDIA CES keynote at CES 2025 here from Las Vegas, Nevada. I want to say a huge thank you to my sponsors for this event, MSI, Gigabyte, Lexar, and Thermaltake. I got more videos coming at you real soon. I'm going to see if I can take a look at some of the RTX 50 series GPU versions from other people besides NVIDIA, besides the Founders Edition that we saw with that really cool exploded view. Thanks for watching, guys. We'll see you in the next one.